Hey guys, it's Brian from GuideAttacking.com and welcome back to another video tutorial on the GuideAttacking YouTube channel. This is part 4 of the shellcode execution tutorial and we are going to cover the setWindowsHookyX method. So what I've done here is opening up the MSDN documentation on setWindowsHookyX, and as you can see it installs an application defined hook procedure into a hook chain. This means that we are basically going to write shellcode into the target process and use this function to register our shellcode as a window hook. We are going to hook the main window procedure of all the windows in the target process. And what's funny is that the Windows devs themselves said that this can be used to inject a DLL into another process. And that's exactly what we are going to do. So let me jump right into my project here. And we'll start off by simply allocating some memory in the target process. I'll just call it pcodecave. And we are going to call virtual alloc ex and pass the process handle and null pointer and just about 100 bytes, mem commit and mem reserve as always. And set it to page execute read write. In case that fails, if not pcodecave, we are going to set the last win32 error to get last error. Oops. And we are going to return srswhex error can't alloc mem. After that's done, we have to grab ourselves a function pointer to the function call next hooky x. So I'll explain that in a second. I'll just call the function pointer pcallNextHookyX and set it equal to getProcAddressEX. Make sure to call getProcAddressEX and not just getProcAddress. Pass the process handle and set lpModule name to user32.dll and call nextHookyX. So as I said, we're going to add a hook to a hook chain, and we have to make sure that all of the hooks in the chain get executed. So when our shellcode is called, we have to actually forward the call to the next hooks using call next hooky x. So if not pcall next hooky x, we have to free the memory we allocated. So call virtual free ex, pass the process handle, pass pcodecave, set the size to 0 and memory release as free type as always, and just return srswhex cn hex missing. So cn hex just stands for call next hooky x. After that's done, we are going to start setting up our shellcode. So if def win64 else and if, and as always, I'm going to quickly grab the code cave from my notes here because it's just a ton of bytes as always right here. And yeah, so let me talk you quickly through this. So we got three buffers here. The first one is to store the argument to for proroutine and a bunch of returned values. Then we have a pointer to the function we want to call and a pointer to call next hooky x. Here's the actual shellcode. So the code fset will be 0x18. First of all, we are going to push RBP and RSP and RBX because we want to use RBX to store some values. First of all, we're going to load the pointer to the code cave, so the pointer to this address, into RBX. If that's done, we are going to reserve 20 bytes on the stack. And we are going to rearrange some arguments to call next hooky x. So it doesn't really matter, we just have to rearrange the arguments so we can probably call this function. If you want, you can check out the type defs for call next hooky x and for window hook. We are going to call next hooky x, update the stack, and store the returned value into RCX. After that's done, here's our jump instruction. This jump instruction currently only jumps to the next instruction. After that's done, we're going to hot patch this jump that instead of jumping to the next instruction, it will jump, I think, to the pop instructions here. And that way we make sure that our shellcode, our injection shellcode, only gets executed once. Because, as I said, we are going to attach this to various windows and not just one. We have to make sure it only gets executed once. So we are going to load a pointer to the argument into RCX, and in the same step we are also going to store RCX into RBX. So I'm using the exchange instruction to swap these two. Then just reserve stack, call proroutine, update the stack, exchange the return value with RBX again, and restore the registers and return. So as I just said, oops, the code offset will be 0x18. So dword code offset equals 0x18. And the checkbyte offset will be the offset to the byte, to the jump byte, to this one. And that's, as you can see, at the jump is at 0x21. So this byte is at 0x22. So set this equal to 0x22 plus code offset, of course. Plus code offset. Now we are going to set up the buffers and just recast it into a double void pointer. And the first one will be shellcode plus 0, and that's equal to parc. Then also reinterpret cast, again a double void, shellcode plus 08x, and that's equal to proroutine. And last but not least, reinterpret cast, void, shellcode plus, oh, not shell about shellcode, plus 0x10, and that's equal to pcall next to keyx. Very important here. That's the 64-bit shellcode. Let me quickly copy and paste the 32-bit shellcode. So this one will be a little bit different. Let me quickly set the project to x86. Basically the same stuff. Save a pointer to parc, just a buffer for parc and a buffer for proroutine. And here we are just going to do the regular x86 stack frame creation, so push EBP, mof EBP, ESP. Then, just like we did here, we have to mess with the arguments to set them up to call next hooky x. After that's done, here's our jump instruction, just like last time. It will jump to the next instruction. Does some stuff, push the arguments, and here I'm going to patch the jump again, that it skips the call to our actual routine, store the returned value, pop all the registers, return, restore the base pointer and the stack pointer, and just return. So I actually copied a little bit too much here, my bad. Anyway, so set code offset to 8, because we have two buffers here, set it to 8. And the checkbyte offset, as you can see, the jump is at 13. So the checkbyte is at 14 at the code offset. So I'll quickly rewrite this part, just ignore that. Reinterpret cast, void pointer, double void pointer, shellcode, plus 0, and that's equal to parc, and reinterpret cast, void shellcode plus 4, 0x04 will be equal to proroutine. So now, unlike in the x64 shellcode, we have to do some other patches here and here for the call next hook call and for grabbing parc. And this will look like this. Actually, let's cast this into a dword pointer. And it will be shellcode again plus this offset at 0x0f. And oh, I almost forgot the code offset, my bad. And set this to reinterpret cast dword pcall next hooky x minus. This will look kind of complicated, but I'll explain it in a second. Plus, minus in brackets, in curved brackets, reinterpret cast dword pcode cave, code cave plus 0xe plus code offset and outside the curly bracket minus 5. So what we are essentially doing here is just patching this relative call instruction to call next hook. It looks kind of complicated, but we just have to grab the address of pcall next hook, then we have to grab the address of the call instruction, subtract the address of the call instruction from pcall next hook, and also subtract 5 bytes for the length. If you've done x68 hooking or something, you have done this many times. It just looks kind of complicated, but basically we're just going to calculate the relative address from the call instruction to call next hook EX. And last but not least, let's also patch this here, the loading of parc, and this will just be another double void, shellcode at offset 18 plus code offset, and set this equal to reinterpret cast. No need for reinterpret cast, you just set it to pcodecave. Like this. That should be it for our shellcoding. And now let's write the shellcode into memory. So if not write process memory h target process pcodecave, shellcode will be the buffer and size of shellcode, of course, and last but not least a null pointer. And in case that fails, we are just going to grab the last win32 error. Then we are going to deallocate the memory, the shellcode, h target process, pcodecave, 0 and memory release as always, and return sr sw hex error write process memory fail. If that's done, we're going to declare a static enum windows callback data. I'll just call it data. And that's the reason why we make it static. You'll see that in a second. After that's done, we're just going to clear the hook data just to be sure it's empty. Then we are going to set up some data in this. And set data mp hook to reinterpret cast hook proc, reinterpret cast byte pointer in this case, pcodecave plus code offset. So the only thing we do here is setting the hook proc member of our enum windows callback data structure to the pointer of the code cave, so pcodecave plus code offset. Then we are also going to set the M process ID member. Let's actually rearrange this here really quick and just set it to get process ID h target process. After that's done, last but not least, we're going to initialize the MH module member just by grabbing the get module by using get module handle like this text. And just set it to user32.dll, like this. So that now that's done, we are going to define a lambda. So, and it will be of the W and window enum proc type. And I'll just call it enum windows callback. Instead of a lambda, we could also use another function, but this way just seems cleaner to me. And it'll take an h window and an lparam. The lparam doesn't really matter. And the return type will be a boolean. Make sure to set this to a boolean capital and not a boolean in lowercase, because the capital bool is actually defined as an integer. I don't know why. Ask Bill Gates. And of course, don't forget the semicolon at the bottom of the lambda. In the lambda, we are going to declare two dwords. The first one will be dword winPID, and just set it to 0, and another dword winTID for thread ID, and that will be get window thread ID. thread processor, sorry, pass the window handle and a reference to the winPID dword we just created. And if winPID equals data dot m underscore, sorry, process ID, like this, then we are going to do some stuff. Yeah, this is, by the way, the reason why I declared this one as static, because if we make this static, this lambda can actually access it. If we don't make it static, the lambda would have to be a capture lambda like this. But if we did that, we can't make it the type window enumeration procedure. And we need this to be, we need the lambda to be of this type, otherwise we can't pass it to enum windows later. So make sure to make this one static. And so in this, we are just going to create a teacher buffer window max path, initialize it with zeros. And if the window is visible, so if window visible, hvint, and get window text, and just pass the window handle, the text buffer we just created, and max path for the character count. And if that succeeds, we are going to do another check. If get class name, hvint, and we're just going to reuse the teacher buffer we created. Again, max path. And so if get class name succeeds, and if compare SC window to text console window class like this. So what we are doing here, we first grab the class name of the window, and if it's not equal to console window class, then we're going to proceed, because setWindowsHookyX doesn't work on console windows. So we have to make sure we don't try to attach to a console window. So if that works, we are going to create an hook, and call setWindowsHookyX. Doesn't really matter whether you call the Unicode or ANSI version, and just use the wh call window proc ID thingy and pass data.mphook data.mhmodule, and last but not least the window thread ID. And in case hook is not zero, we are going to push it back in the hook data member, in the hook data member of our data structure, push back. And here we are going to create a new hook data, just like this, by passing the returned hook value of that Windows hooky X and the window handle. So that's it for our lambda. Let's move on. So now we are going to enumerate all windows. If not enum windows, and pass the lambda we just created in a Windows callback, and reinterpret cast lparam and data like this. Actually, this isn't really necessary, but just to make sure stuff works, we are going to pass it that way. I forgot to remove the equal sign here in the lambda. Make sure there's no equal sign in these brackets. So in case that fails, let's simply grab, as always, the last win32 error, set it to get last error, and because I'm lazy, I'm quickly going to copy this virtual free x and return srswhex error enum windows fail. So in case enum windows succeeded, but our hook data vector is empty, that means that in the lambda no setWindowsHookyX function succeeded, so no Windows hook was installed. We again will free the code cave and return another error code. SRSW hex error no windows. I just called it this. Maybe there are some Windows console windows or hidden windows or something like that, but that won't work. So let's create another hvent. I'll call it h foreground window because we are going to grab the handle to the foreground window using the get foreground window API. And now for we are going to use a range based for loop, and we are going to enumerate through data.mhhook data, so through the mhhook data vector, and we are just going to set the current hvent to the foreground window. Then we are going to send a message. I'll just use send message A in this case. I.mhwindow wm key down, and we are just going to send a space, so spacebar, and a zero for lparam. Then we are going to sleep for 10 milliseconds, and after that's done, send message A again. Again, i.mhwindow, and this time wm key up. So first we're going to press space, but then we are going to reset, and vk space again. And again a zero for the lparam. And after that's done, our hook was executed, and we can just unhook. We can use unhook Windows X to remove our hook and mhhook this one. So we can simply unhook this. In case it didn't work, we still may have a bunch of other hooks in the target process, so there's absolutely nothing wrong with just trying to unhook it from this one window. After we have looped through all of the windows, we're just going to restore the original foreground window. So set foreground window and pass h foreground window. So just in case we change the foreground window, we are going to set it back to the original. So now we are going to create a timer to wait for the shellcode to be executed. So debug timer equals get tick count, and by checkbyte equals zero. Checkbyte equals zero, yeah. And a do while loop. So while not checkbyte, while checkbyte is zero. And in this loop, we are going to use read process memory on h target process, reinterpret cast, byte pointer on p code cave. Code cave plus checkbyte offset, and of course pass checkbyte as buffer, one in size, null pointer, and close the bracket. So, and if get tick count, so just our regular timeout thingy, minus timer is bigger than SR remote timeout, which I've just set to 5 seconds if I recall correctly, we're going to return SRSW hex error timeout. And after that, we're just going to sleep for 10 milliseconds again, like this. After that's done, we're going to read process memory again to read the returned value of the remote function, pcode cave, and remote read. Actually, it seems like I forgot to define remote read here. That's weird. Oh, well, I'll just fix it in a second. And remote read, size of remote read, and a null pointer. So give me a second. I'll just quickly look up. Actually, I think, yeah. Just use out, not remote read. I for some reason got the wrong name for the variable. Pass out by reference and size of out. And last but not least, virtual free the shellcode. It has It has been executed and all hooks have been unregistered, so we can now safely remove the hook from memory and pass pcodecave again and 0 and mem release and return SR error success. So that should be it for this injection method. Let me go to the main file and I'll simply use for x68. We're currently in x68. So I can't inject in my test console because, as I said, this doesn't work for console windows. So instead, I'm just going to inject into the VLC media player and just put it here and hit inject. Well, just start debugger, not really inject. Oh yeah, and I completely forgot, sorry. Code generation failed. Yeah, I completely forgot to make the lambda return something. Haha. just put a return true down here, like this. And I also forgot in the main to actually change the launch method. Set this to set Windows Hookie X, like this. And drumroll, and it works perfectly. The DLL got executed and I accidentally paused it, and media player is still working. So let's now, oops, I didn't mean to open that one, go back to this, and for x64 I'm simply going to inject into the calculator, into this one. I've got actually the old calculator because I just preferred, and set this to x64 and run the debugger. Drum roll, perfect, and it's working just fine, and as you can see the calculator still works like a charm. Perfect. Well, that's it for this part of the tutorial, and in the next part we are going to cover QUser APC, which will be the final part of the shellcode execution tutorial. Bye!